All right, guys, I have my tea, have my notes, and I'm finally going to rank this year's Hugo Awards novella finalists. Actually, the tea is just because I'm filming multiple videos today and I've been losing my voice really, really easily. I don't know what's going on. It might be like the air quality or allergies or something, but it's annoying. I almost didn't do this video because I just didn't enjoy, well, novellas very much. But I try to be dedicated to self-imposed projects. It's part of being a classical musician, after all. And I had added this category for myself this year of reading all the finalists for Best Novella for the Hugo Awards. And I did complain about them a lot in my monthly wrap-ups. But other than that, I need to actually close out this part of the project by actually reviewing and ranking these novellas. And I just need to do it. I read most of them, I think, before the end of June. So it's now the end of September. This might be a little bit distant in my memory, but we're gonna do our best. So what I'm gonna do today is just give a very brief description of each one as I go through and rank them. This is my personal order of preference. This is not my prediction on how I think the results of the award will come out. This is just my personal ranking, and I'm gonna do one of these videos for each category. Except I did just realize when I went through all the Hugo stuff, there's a novella that I need to read for the Best New Writer category, so we'll talk about that another time. I was trying to do something that I thought would be good for me because a lot of people seem to really like novellas, and I wanted to be part of that, so I wanted to read the best novella category, and it just didn't work out for me very well because apparently I just still don't like novellas. I am a person that loves epic fantasy, so maybe this makes sense. I love getting to experience things by just going along for a long, complicated ride, getting immersed in something, getting to just really experience a different world or different situation or different character. And I feel like novellas just don't seem to really afford the space for that. And that's probably why most of them I don't really like. And the ones that I have enjoyed more are generally just part of a long-running series or are, part of something else that I enjoy. This is kind of going to be a ranking of things that I didn't enjoy that much. I'm sorry. I think all of these probably have positive reviews out there, and you should definitely go and find some. I'm not going to trash them either because I honestly don't think any of these things are necessarily objectively bad. There's a lot of discussion out there about objectivity versus subjectivity, but I don't even think these are subjectively bad. I just didn't enjoy them. So I feel like my ranking, this is really just which ones I enjoyed the experience of reading the most, and I feel like a lot of times that actually came down to how novel-like was it. Which is a little unfair, but there you have it. Please give me a little bit of a free pass. Some of these I read like 3+ months ago, so I'm gonna do my best to talk about them, but I might get a detail or something wrong. Just forgive me. Sorry, I should have filmed this sooner, but I was procrastinating. Probably my least favorite was Riot Baby by Tochi Onyebuchi. This was my first thing that I ever read by Tochi Onyebuchi, so I really can't compare it to his novels or anything else by him. I just really didn't enjoy the experience of reading this one very much. The story is about two siblings, Ella and Kev. Kev is the title character, so to speak, the Riot Baby. He's born in South LA in 1992 during the LA riots. The novella follows these characters and kind of their world as they experience a lot of hardship and systemic racism, and Kev ends up getting unjustly incarcerated as a teenager. His sister Ella, who we also get some POV from, she has sort of not that well-defined magical powers that basically start out as her being able to see the future of various characters, but then by the end of the story, she has basically a lot more, I won't spoil anything, but she develops a lot more abilities, which are the rules of this are not too well defined. It falls more into almost like a magical realism kind of urban fantasy. Even though this was my least favorite, I honestly feel like if it had been maybe developed out into a novel, because the writing is really emotional and powerful, I think if I had had more time with the characters or if just things had been fleshed out a little more and made a little more sense, I think I could have really enjoyed this. But it was really just my problem with it is just that it was all emotion and no substance. It kind of took this weird turn into like a dystopian future, and just there wasn't really that much of a constructed plot. It was about the issues, it was about the feelings, and I could sort of see where that was coming from. But just as a reading experience, I wanted the structure, the plot, something that's just purely emotional and short just didn't really work for me as a reading experience. But this is also something that I have the feeling was very personal and emotional for the author. So also, if it didn't work for me, that's okay. Like, I don't mean to criticize that. If it did end up being the thing that the author wanted, I'm just ranking these according to how my reading experience went. Okay, novella number two, Upright Women Wanted by Sarah Gailey. This is the second thing I've read by Sarah Gailey. I read her book Magic for Liars, and it was honestly probably one of my least favorite reads of 2020, unfortunately. I was not very into it, and that was a full novel. So this novella, it was just a little too punchline-y and not very substantive for me, where things didn't really feel very fleshed out or didn't really necessarily make a whole lot of sense. The premise actually seems really fun. It's set in a dystopian future that has kind of a Wild West feel, where everything is controlled by kind of a like religious authoritarian government, kind of Handmaid's Tale-esque, but not really. Not really in terms of feel, but like in terms of concept, maybe a little bit. The government is super controlling about approved reading material and propaganda and what people are allowed to consume. And there are these librarians, like traveling librarians, that go from town to town and deliver approved materials, I guess. So our main character, Esther, is running away from her father. She's escaping an arranged marriage. Her best friend, who she was in love with, just got executed for reading some unapproved materials. So she's kind of like on the run and also trying to find herself and figure out what's true after a lifetime of propaganda. So again, there are a lot of elements here that I think could be really cool maybe in a novel. I like the idea of the characters, the futuristic mashup, dystopian Wild West. Like, it all sounds very cool. It's just after I read it, it didn't really feel like there was a heck of a lot there, if that makes sense. Next, in the number four spot, I'm putting The Empress of Salt and Fortune by Nevo. This one was really a mix for me because I still didn't enjoy it, but I actually loved the writing, and I would love to read a novel-length work by her because while this novella didn't work for me, again, even more so than the first two that I talked about, there are things here that I could love in different circumstances. This story is from the point of view of a young cleric who runs into an elderly woman who used to be a servant of the empress, and this empress had come from a foreign country and married into the empire and was treated really horribly and then eventually came to power. And so the former servant is telling bits of this story as we go along through the novella, sometimes kind of tied to different objects from this abandoned palace. And so you get sort of little snapshots of how this came to be. So I loved the overall concept, the setting, the writing. It's just the story was so episodic and not fleshed out, and it never really told you the interesting parts. And I think it was supposed to be like these little personal glimpses of this epic story. So I kind of liked the idea of it. It just wasn't very satisfying to read at all. But, and I think there's a sequel, which I'm not planning to read, but I really would like to read some books by Nevo. I think she has at least one novel length work. So yeah, I loved the writing and the idea. It just, the form let me down. It just wasn't something I really enjoy. I wanted to hear all of it. I wanted to know more about all the politics and stuff and how it all worked out instead of just these little glimpses. Next, in number three, I'll put Finna by Nino Cipri. This one I actually enjoyed okay because it wasn't like aspiring to a scope that I felt like was bigger than the size of the novella. It was touching and cute and kind of entertaining. I don't think I would have picked it out if it hadn't been for this Hugo Awards project, but it's about two minimum wage employees at a kind of big Scandinavian furniture store that's definitely not IKEA. And on their shift, an old lady gets sucked through a wormhole that suddenly appears. And it turns out that these wormholes are actually a thing, and the company used to have a division that would deal with them. But now that has all been shut down because money. So instead, their manager basically sends them to go try to retrieve this old lady from some alternate universe. And so off they go. And the twist is that these two employees actually used to be in a relationship and broke up about a week before the story starts. So yeah, I found this to be quite fun. I don't have a lot to say about it, but you know, I enjoyed it, I think, for what it was. It was nice. Yeah, I'm ranking that as number three. As my number two, I'm putting Come Tumbling Down by Shannon McGuire. This is number five in the Wayward Children series. And yes, I actually read all of the Wayward Children series for this, including up through number six, which I didn't need to. And I didn't like the Wayward Children series. I keep talking about maybe making a video about it, but I kind of just haven't been in the mood to make a whole video about a series I didn't enjoy because I'm not feeling particularly ranty about it. I just didn't connect with it very much. I like Shannon McGuire's writing. I like the Encrypted series, which is super fun. Middle Game, actually, you know, I overall enjoyed, even though I think the book had some structural flaws. But Wayward Children just takes itself so darn seriously all the time. She is trying too hard to be deep and profound and meaningful, and I think I like her writing better when she's just being really silly. I'm putting this as number two, which I think just goes to show how little I liked any of these, really. But I think the reason, you know, when I came to do the overall ranking, even though I didn't really enjoy Wayward Children, I think I still had some more investment in the series just because I had read five of them at this point instead of just one. So I just, you know, there was a little more there for me to latch onto. As for where I would rank Come Tumbling Down within the Wayward Children series, I don't know. I didn't really like any of them that much. I'm sorry. I'm sorry if you're a big fan of the Wayward Children series. And if you tried that series and you didn't like it and you think you don't like Shannon McGuire, just go try it. Go read Discount Armageddon. Try the Encrypted series. You'll get a very different perspective. And you might still not like it because it's pulpy and silly, but you know, if that's for you, you might enjoy it. Okay, finally, my number one, which is sort of a sad number one because, like I said, I didn't enjoy any of these all that much. My number one was Ring Shout by P. Jelly Clark. And the main reason this was number one for me is because out of all of these novellas, this one gave me the experience of getting a complete story, a complete mini novel with world building, character development, setting, everything, you know, in the novella length. And so there was just so much more for me to connect to. I'm actually very excited to try reading his Cairo series. I think the first one is A Dead Djinn in Cairo, but I can't remember. I can't remember all the titles right now. I would have to look it up. But I've been wanting to try that series anyway. And this was a nice sample of his writing. It was kind of, you know, emotionally, this was not an easy story to read. It's set in Macon, Georgia during the Prohibition era. The main character is one of a group of kind of like bootleggers, I guess. They're bootleggers, but they're also fighting these monsters from another dimension that they call Ku Kluxes. And the novella is also kind of about hatred and the movie Birth of a Nation, which I actually didn't know too much about, and now I know what it's about. But yeah, so obviously not easy stuff to read, but I really just enjoyed the development of the story. The main character has a kind of tormented past, and she has a magical sword, and there's a lot more folklore and legend woven into this world building. I just thought, compared to all the other novellas that I've ranked today, that I've talked about today, this one had the most substance, and because of that, I connected to it the most. So that's why I'm putting this in my number one spot. I have no idea. I kind of hope that the people who are actually going to vote on this are people that actually like novellas in the first place. I think that might get a very different ranking because I feel like I kind of ranked on what felt the most complete to me because that's the reading experience I like. So this is purely my personal opinion, but let me know down below if you've read any of these, what you thought of them. Are there any novellas that you guys really love that I might connect to better, especially if they are more novel-like? And yeah, now I can say that I have done this. I can put the Hugo novella thing to rest and I can just move on with my reading life. And I probably will not do this category if I do a Hugo Awards project in 2022.